I didn't understand a lot of mine, but, you know, grandma would try to, but they all did die.
Savings. Savings all the way out.
Okay, so we're going to continue our look at the scripture exposition. We're going through 1 Peter 3:15. Sanctify the Lord God in your hearts and be always ready always to give an answer to every man that asketh you a reason of the hope that is in you with meekness and fear. So we've talked about what it means to sanctify. It means to set apart. So we're setting God apart in our hearts. That is, we are putting him on the highest place. He is our highest authority, our highest priority in our hearts. And be ready always. We've talked about that word and what it means to be ready. And so let's look at this portion to give an answer. To give an answer. And that word answer comes from the Greek apologia, which we get what? Apologetics from, right? And so apologia, which means a word in defense of. And we've talked about, we went over it in the eternal kingdom, that question, and we revisited that question at the beginning in this, in the introduction to this study. Am I required to be an apologist? Yes, right? Well, I think we came to that conclusion. It is my responsibility to speak in defense of the truth. That's the Christian mission, right? And a lot of times we can't do that, for instance, by keeping silent, can we? A part of what we do is we take the gospel to all the world and we present it to everyone, and silence does not characterize that mission, does it? And just putting up with attacks on the truth does not characterize that mission, does it? So we are required, as Peter says, to give an answer. And in order to do that, we have to have evidence and properly handle that evidence. We're about to open up the study talking about how to demonstrate a proposition. And that is going to require examining and considering evidence and then properly handling it, properly putting it into argument form. And so we've got to do that in order to give an answer. And so this is very pertinent to our study, right? Oh, the door's open. That's why that's loud. So any comments or questions? All right. So how to demonstrate a proposition? Let me get there in my notes. How to demonstrate a proposition. And I think in this section we could just as well be called how to decipher and communicate truth, basically. And so these principles should not be, we shouldn't view the idea of a proposition to just debating. A lot of times we seem to think that argument is just used in debate. Well, it ought to be used internally as well. We need to be examining what we believe and what we hold to be true, and part of doing that is using reasoning, the whole point of the study, logic. And so I kind of view this lesson as, you know, when you're tying a shoe and you're lacing up the shoe. You're not even tying it yet. You're lacing up the shoe and you're putting the aglet, each of the aglets through each eyelet in the shoe, and then at the end you do what? You pull it taut, right? You pull the shoe, each side of the shoe together. And in my mind, this is what we're doing in this lesson, where everything's coming together, hopefully. And so, how to demonstrate a proposition? First of all, what does it mean to demonstrate a proposition? Well, it means to provide evidence, proof, that supports a specific statement or claim. Anybody recall what the law of rationality is? It's the first law we discussed. So that's the first eyelet we put the aglet through, is the law of rationality, which is one should not hold a conclusion that is such as is not warranted by the evidence. One should not hold a conclusion that the evidence does not suggest. Make sense? You don't, for instance, look at the evidence and dismiss it and then, you know, this is my conclusion, this is what I believe, and not even considering, not examining, and not considering the evidence. One should not draw such conclusions as are not warranted by the evidence. So to demonstrate a proposition first requires research. So that's compiling, considering the evidence. Simply read your Bible. As if we're talking about doctrine, read your Bible. If you're talking about, and we're going to look at some stuff later, the existence of God, examine the evidence. Put it out, all out on the table. Show of hands, who knows why they believe in God? Who could tell someone why they believe in God? Can you do it? You ought to. Is faith a blind leap in the dark? No. You should be able to tell yourself and others why you believe in God. There should be a logical sequence there, an explanation. So research, compiling and considering evidence. Then you have rational thought, that it is what it requires. And that's properly handling the evidence that you've compiled and you've considered. Effective communication is required in demonstrating a proposition, because you've got to, you know, we've researched it for ourselves, we've compiled it, we've considered it, we've used rationality to do something with that evidence, and now it requires effective communication to be able to tell others, guide others through that rational thought. Everybody with me? So, modern debates tend to lack the skill of demonstrating a proposition. We're getting into the political season, and I've seen one debate already, that they're really just forums now. Back in the day, I'm sure Abraham Lincoln and Stephen Douglas, I'd like to read some of that debate. I haven't yet. But I bet that it was structured much differently than it is today. The trend of modern debates, what do? Use emotion and persuasion, or emotional persuasion, over logic. So they connect with their audience through, they know what kind of words and arguments to use to connect with their audience emotionally. And we see that all the time. Like, you mean to tell me that my dear aunt who passed away, she's a great woman, but she's a good woman, and she wasn't baptized into the church, but you mean to tell me she wasn't saved? That's an emotional argument, isn't it? That's an appeal to emotion. So, but you have that in political debates, prioritization being given to connecting with an audience emotionally. Then you have simplification or sound bites, motivated by sound bites. These politicians, they will call a debate won if they can come away with some sound bites that, you know, just 30-second clips that they can play on the radio. So, that's a simplification of subjects. The Warren flu debate, which we reference a lot here, took place over 3 days. It was a couple hours each night over 3 days. And it was structured in such a way that Brother Warren, he gave an affirmative position, that is, he's giving you a proposition, which we're about to do. He's giving this statement, and he's confirming it as true. Then Anthony Flew comes in afterward. He gets the same amount of time allotted to Warren. They're equal. And he says, no, that statement's false. Warren just said was true. I'm saying it's false, and this is why. And they went back and forth like that. Debates don't do that anymore, do they? You're not even forced to look at the proposition of your opponent anymore. And we have one coming up with Kyle Butt, right? In October. So it'll be interesting. I'm sure they're going to structure that one well. But it's going to be an hour, I think. So it's not even going to, it's not going to be the same as Warren Flew. Yes, sir.
I remember when we were talking about debates and everything, when Tom dropped the Kyle Butt against somebody that used to be a minister in the church.
Mm-hmm.
And just hearing that guy, just my mind is gone. And he was a minister, he had all of this. I mean, but,
mm-hmm.
You know. And I just wonder how people in or out of the church can do that.
Yeah.
They know or really don't know, and maybe we can help them.
Yep. And a lot of these debates are kind of the debates. We should probably give them air quotes when we say this. But a lot of these debates, they're not geared toward finding the truth. They're geared toward... like we say, sound bites, confirmation bias we see in debates. Confirmation bias is what? You hold a position and the audience, you might give a position and you'll connect to the audience members, and the audience members, you're just going to go with who they agreed with at the start of the debate, right? So that's confirmation bias on their part. You have a misinterpretation or misrepresentation of the evidence. You have cherry-picked evidence in debates these days. And then you have basically a lack of literacy of the audience. Most people have no clue how a properly construction or what a properly constructed proposition looks like. They don't know. They don't know what a good framed argument looks like. And so debaters will take advantage of that as well. And so they don't know what a proposition looks like and wouldn't know what to look for when it's being refuted. They just have that confirmation bias. They're like, I agree with what he said. I agreed with him at the beginning. So that's what modern debates seem to look like today. Any comments or questions?
I would say... sometimes I think we don't see it necessary to provide evidence. For all kinds of contexts. But if you look at like Job, for example, God lays out in his response evidence after evidence after evidence for Job to consider the creation regarding who God is. And if there was ever anyone who did not need to lay out evidence because of who he is, it's God.
Mm-hmm.
Yet God has done that consistently throughout time, and then also we have, of course, the Bible to look at. And so it takes work, and it's hard to dig into the evidence that justifies our positions.
Mm-hmm.
But the reality is, we are not above that,
yeah.
Nor should we think of ourselves to be above that. And I would argue this too, it's good practice to consider it in multiple contexts. You know, to just say something and then just take it on any matter can become a dangerous habit.
Mm-hmm.
So regardless of the area, you talk about football stats. Well, you know, let me go check that. You know, it slows you down, of course, mm-hmm. especially in our world today. But, you know, we should root ourselves in factual evidence, not,
right.
Like I said, emotional, or maybe I have a connection to this person. So, of course, whatever they say is right.
Right, yeah.
It should really be the way we pattern our thoughts, which then ultimately will help us as it relates to eternity.
Right, exactly.
I have a... I was in prison training. We attended quite a few debates. It was a big part of our education, but I think there's one that sticks out in my mind, and I don't think I'll ever forget. And it was a debate in Biloxi, Mississippi, with a professor, I believe it was Harding, and between an atheist and him. But this atheist brought out, and he was a respectful looking fellow, real gray headed, silver headed, older, and people could have probably respect him if they, fell into the line of atheism. But he brought out that this man over in Africa had brought back this native boy. And he says, this proves that man came for the monkey. He said, this little boy had a monkey tail. And sure enough, he had a picture of him. Well, the professor at Harding had done his homework, and he read this article where some of his friends played a trick on him. And they had actually cut off a tail of a monkey and pinned it on that little boy.
Wow.
So the atheist, he said, oh, I didn't know that, I'm sorry.
I wonder if that was before DNA too. Not before DNA, but before they knew how to look at it. But we also, I don't want us to get it in our heads. That's where I was going with this. Was this isn't just for debate, like what you were saying. We're to work out our own salvation with fear and trembling. We don't lean on other men to provide us what to believe. We need to be doing this for ourselves, considering the evidence and properly handling the evidence. And we can be led astray easily if we don't know how to reason logically, which we've seen from the beginning of this whole class. God expects us to reason logically. So why is it important to know how to demonstrate a proposition? Because it concerns how we arrive at the truth, and that's important. Ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free, as we see in John chapter 8 and verse 32. And I'd also like to turn over to Titus. By the way, we're going to be talking about in 1 Peter 3:15 as we look more at that verse, that we are to be ready always to give an answer. The adjectives meekness and fear are going to come into play. When we think debate, we think, I'm right. There's a challenge, and there's somebody that's going to win, somebody that's going to lose. Well, we need to be going about demonstrating propositions, convincing others of the truth with meekness. That means we realize we have the truth, but we do it under control. We need to control our attitudes when we go through it, when we do this. Titus chapter 1, verses 6 through 11, someone please.
If any be blameless, the husband of one wife, having faithful children not accused of riot or unruly. For a bishop must be blameless as the steward of God, not self-willed, not soon angry, not given to wine, no striker, not given to filthy lucre, but a lover of hospitality, a lover of good men, sober, just, holy, temperate, holding fast the faithful words as he's been taught, that he may be able to sound by sound doctrine, both to exhort and convince the gainsayers. And for there are many unruly and vain talkers and deceivers, especially they of the circumcision, whose mouths, can we go through 11?
Yes, sir.
Whose mouths must be stopped, whose servant hold houses, teaching things which they ought not, for filthy lucre's sake.
All right, thank you, brother. So this is going through some qualifications for the elders here. But a lot of these qualifications are stuff we all ought to aspire to. And part of this, looking in verses 9 and following, that we are to hold fast the faithful word as he hath been taught, that he might be able to, by sound doctrine, to both exhort and to convince the gainsayers. How are you going to convince somebody of sound doctrine? How do you do that?
You have to know what the doctrine is.
You have to open it up. Did you say the word evidence? Yep, you open it up, you examine the evidence, and you properly handle it. That's how you convince others. You take the evidence that you have, you put it in a form that supports the truth, and you present it to them. That's how you convince. And then you have in verses 10 and following that there are people out there that will talk and deceive. How do you battle them? You gotta know how to demonstrate propositions, to put out the evidence, properly handle it, and communicate it. Everybody with me? All right, so that's why it's important to know how to demonstrate a proposition. So gathering the evidence, just quickly, gathering the evidence, there's all kinds of evidence that you can consider. And the first piece of evidence doesn't, most of these have to do with doctrinal issues, but that first one, empirical evidence, we're going to be using in just a little bit. Empirical evidence is that which is seen and experienced by someone. It's evidence that you've seen with your own eyes. You've seen this with your own eyes. You've tasted this. You've touched this. You've heard this. You've witnessed this, basically. That's empirical evidence. And we talked about empiricism earlier on, where some men will say, well, unless I've got to see it to know it. And what they do when they say that is they discount logic. So we're not being empiricists, but we are considering empirical evidence. All evidence has to be considered. And that is what we experience, as well as that which is taught in the Bible. All of it is to be considered. Empirical evidence. You have lexical evidence. The word lexicon. What's a lexicon got in it? Words, right? So a lexical evidence means concerning the meaning of words. That's what that means. So we'll see that later on, in just some examples, that the inspired writers of the Bible put a lot of importance on the meaning of words. They placed a lot of import on the meaning of words and the grammar of words, even. So, which involves syntactical evidence concerning the way those words are put together. Then you have historical evidence, circumstances that call forth the writing of a certain thing. And then you have analogical evidence, which is the evidence of the whole trend of Scripture, taking things in context with one another. So all these are different kinds of evidence. I'm probably missing something there, but just a shorthand list of types of evidence. Any comments or questions?
Well, I think it speaks to the value of Kone Greek, which died.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
New Testament. Especially if you look at our world today, as you mentioned, there are politicians and debates and so forth. What people do is they just change the definition. So why has their policy, quote, not changed? Well, because they just changed the meaning of this word or that word in the policy. People do it in courtrooms every day. They try to redefine terms, and you know, famously, we had a president that says it depends on what the definition of is. So, Kone Greek died.
Yep.
It didn't evolve. It didn't change. It didn't shift. And so, when we go to understand the definition of the words written by the writers, it is what it is.
Yep.
I mean, that's strong.
A dead language, frozen in time. We know exactly what they meant and what they said.
All of this, like, it sounds very, like, formal.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, don't turn your brains off because you see the word syntactical there.
Right.
Just go here. The first one is evidence that you witnessed yourself. Second one is what words mean. The third one is how the words are put together. Then you have what's the historical context of those words. Then you have analogical, which is what is the entire context of the word being given to us. So hopefully the words don't throw you off. I would not have been able to throw those up there without studying this at home. So this is an example that you will see in probably just about every secular philosophy book that goes through Aristotle's logic. And they use Aristotle as an example. What you have here is two premises and a conclusion. This is what they call a syllogism. We've used that word some. So the first one is all men are mortal, right? Let me stop for a second. Any argument you can make, if you can reduce it to this simplicity, then it's very helpful. And you can if an argument is true, if it's worth holding, or if a position is worth holding, you can come to it in something that's formed like this. So this is a good, we don't speak to one another in syllogisms. It's not natural to us, but we can break it down and reason it, and we can better understand what somebody else is trying to argue if we can try to understand what their argument is by trying to put it in this form, and then we can better understand the position that we hold by trying to put it in this form. So this is why I've started here with demonstrating a proposition. So that first premise number one, you'll see all men are mortal, right? Second premise, Aristotle is a man. Therefore, that's what those three dots mean, Aristotle is mortal. So, and we've seen enough of this already in this class to recognize the pattern, right? So all men are mortal, Aristotle is a man, Aristotle is mortal. Now also, don't turn your brain off when I use the word subject and predicate right now. What's the subject of a sentence? Subject is what the sentence is talking about, right? It's a what person, place, or thing. Yes, ma'am. That is the subject of a sentence, right? So it's an easy way to understand that. The subject of a sentence is what the sentence is talking about. That's real broken down simple. So all men are mortal. What's the subject of that sentence? Men, right? And all would be modifying men. It's talking about all men are mortal. What's the predicate? Is the predicate... Wait. Yeah, verb. Wouldn't mortal be? It's the verb? Okay. What is mortal? What is the... Okay. I was afraid of this. What's the part of the sentence that the subject that describes the subject? What do we? Adverb? I don't know. Yeah, mortal is an adjective. Right. Okay. So we've a predicate is not what I thought it was. Topic and descriptor. There you go. One second.
What's a part of a sentence?
So, something that is affirmed or denied of the subject in a proposition in logic. A term designating a property or relation in a sentence. The part of a sentence or clause that expresses what is said of the subject. That's what I was looking for. That's the definition of the predicate. So, the part of the sentence that or clause that expresses what is said of the subject and usually consists of a verb with or without objects, complements, or adverbial modifiers. Please don't turn your brain off. Let's look at that first sentence. All men are mortal. The subject is men, right? What is being said about men? They're mortal. Okay. So that would be the predicate. And I could be wrong about that. That's what my understanding was before, but I'm not super confident in myself right now. But all men are mortal. Realize where the placement of mortal. I've got them colored in. What I thought was a predicate would be, I guess, the joining of are mortal. I'm pretty sure the part of a sentence or clause that expresses what is said of the subject. So what is being said of men? They're mortal, right? Okay. So all men, realize where all men is located in that first sentence and where a man is located in that second sentence, right? So all men are mortal. And then you introduce a new premise. Aristotle is a man, right? So this is a very, this is the simplest form of a syllogism to prove your proposition, which is Aristotle is immortal. If you can put your argument in a form like that, where I'm going to still use it, subject and predicate, and then what the subject becomes the predicate of the next sentence. Aristotle is the subject of that second sentence, and a man would be describing Aristotle, right? So if you can put them in that form, you've proven your point, right? You could put any argument in that form. So hopefully I haven't lost you. I'm going to try something that makes me nervous. Okay. Okay, I'm connected to Wi-Fi. Okay. So, in my mind, I was going to use this tablet to do this together live. So we're going to be putting propositions together. And these propositions we're going to be discussing. First of all, we're going to prove that God is, right? We're going to prove that the Bible is His Word. We're going to prove that the Bible is verbally and the plenary inspired Word of God. And then that the Bible is man's sole authority for all doctrine and practice. So this little illustration here is to show that all of these things are required to get anywhere with someone in discussing the Bible and doctrine. How are you going to convince someone of the truth of any part of God's doctrine or truth if they don't first believe that God is, right? How can you do that if what our standard authority is His Word? If they don't believe that their standard of authority is God's Word, how are you going to convince them of any doctrinal issue? You can't do it, because their standard of authority is what preacher says, or it's what I believe, it's what I feel in my heart. It's not God's Word. So you've got to start, you've got to lay foundations is what I'm getting at. And so we've all got to be on the same page. If you want to have a meaningful discussion with someone, you got to know where the foundation needs to be laid. With some people, it needs to be that God exists. Others, it's the Bible is His Word. And others might believe, well, the Bible's His Word, but I believe that the men that wrote the Bible are inspired, but in the way that a poet is inspired. You know, just he looks out in nature and he's inspired by the beauty, and so he creates something. Is that how the Bible's inspired? No. Bible is word for word inspired. That's what we talk about when we say verbally. And it's plenary. It's all of it is God's Word, not just some of it, right? And then we've got to come to the acknowledgement that the Bible is man's sole authority for all doctrine and practice. So depending on who you're talking to, you're going to have to start with a different foundation. And some people you talk to, they're going to already believe all this. Well, that's great. You can go straight into God's Word, right? So God is, it's kind of erased at the bottom, but this is the principles of authority. And then I have the infinity symbol up there, because just everything is going to be based off of this. Every truth that you can try to convince someone is going to be based on all this. And you can't convince them of it if they don't come to the acknowledgement of all this. Make sense to everybody? Principles of authority. Oh, not using this anymore. So, intelligent design. We want to convince, and I gave you all these over band a while ago. I don't know if you looked at them, but we're wanting to prove that God is, and so I decided to go the intelligent design route. And what we want to, the proposition that we want to demonstrate is that the universe and all it contains was created by an all-powerful intelligent designer. We want to prove that. And who thinks they can prove that to someone? To anyone you think so? Well, let's do it together. What we want to do first, what's the first step in demonstrating a proposition? It's examining the evidence, right? Examining and considering the evidence. So what is the evidence? What evidence do we have here? All men are mortal. Let's see. I'm going to add a layer here. Teleological. Define that. Okay. Everything created has a creator. What if we said designer? Yeah, we could. Yeah. Yeah, it is tomato, tomato. The words mean different things. So a creator, everything created, we could say everything designed, right? As a designer. Make sense? Everything designed has a designer. What else might we want to add to our evidence that we've considered? Anything? Bueller? Okay, so when we look at the world around us, do we see design? Yeah, we could get specific with it. Yeah, we could get specific with it. Stars, yes. What do we know about stars? You can't count them, yeah. You can't count the stars.
You can't count them. You can't count all of them.
Yeah, I guess that's true. Yeah. Okay. Well, we're nearing the end. Let me show you what I've got here, and this will just serve as an example for next week. And I realize you can't read that. I'll read it off. Under the evidence column, what I have here, God is not the God of the gaps. What do I mean when I say that? He says, I mean, we have positive evidence that he exists. It's not the fact that, the universe and all of it, I witness matter and the universe existing, and God is the only explanation, I've got a gap in my knowledge of how everything exists, so God exists. That's not my argument. So God is not the God of the gaps, but the law of biogenesis, what do we know from the law of biogenesis? A lot of this ties into what we've been studying on Sundays. What's that? That life, only life begets life, right? We have the sophistication of the cell. We can look at the cell and say it's pretty sophisticated. The mitochondria has its role. The nucleus has its role. The ribosomes, all of that stuff has its role in the cell and works together, right? And we can see what in the cell. We see design in the cell, right? Also the fact that information emanates from intelligence. How do we get information? Where do messages come from? They come from a messenger, right? There's a messenger that sends a message. And what is DNA? It's information, right? Somebody had to write it. Somebody had to write that message. The cell, the DNA within the cell, is instructions on how our body is built, and every living thing is built. So if it's instructions, something had to write those instructions. Every program had a programmer. Every design has a designer. And the matter itself is not psychological, subjective, or mental. So matter is matter something that is just conjured up by our minds? No. It's not subjective. The existence of this podium is not subjective. It just exists, and I've got no I can do nothing about it except maybe remove it, but it's going to exist somewhere else, right? So it's not subjective, or it's not a figment of my imagination or my mind. It's therefore, there's intelligence. And then free will, the existence of free will is evidence that we can use here. It only makes sense that God put us here as intelligent beings. But intelligent design, what's the argument I have here? Premise one, where there is a design, there must be a designer. Premise one. Premise number two, the universe and all that it contains was clearly designed. Right? See how I've switched the subject there? There's like design, and the universe becomes the subject in premise two, and what are we saying about the universe? It was designed. And so to support these two premises, we've dumbed it down or simplified it into these two premises, but we might want to bring in an argument on the power needed to create the universe, and we might want to bring in an argument on the intelligence needed to design the universe, which says a lot about God if we come to the conclusion that God, or that every design must have a designer. But let's look at that first simplified premise. Where there is a design, there must be a designer. Premise one. Premise number two, the universe and all that it contains was clearly designed. Can anybody deny that what we see is clearly a design? Like everything, our very hands in front of us, the eyes that we use to see the hand in front of us, all of it is clear design. Matter could not have conjured this up on its own. So irrefutable here. Therefore, the universe and all that it contains was created by an all-powerful, intelligent designer, if we bring those other two arguments I mentioned into it. Does that make sense? Think you can argue that to someone if on the street, if you go out and were to talk to somebody who believes that just a small speck of nothing exploded and gave us everything that we see around us? You think you can bring that argument to them? Everybody feel confident they could do that? I think so. So that's what we're looking at, where I'm going through these propositions, how to demonstrate a proposition. Is this clicking? Is it making sense? We're looking at the evidence, saying, okay, so what do I do with this evidence that I have? I properly structured it to prove a proposition that the universe and all that it contains was created by an all-powerful, intelligent designer. Any comments or questions on that? Was the second bell gone?
Yeah.
Is it? Okay, so we'll demonstrate a few more propositions. The next one being, it's not enough to say, okay, there's a God, right? It's not enough to say, okay, I believe in the existence of a creator, but I don't believe that the Bible is God's word. What good is that acknowledgement of the existence of God going to do if I don't believe I have communication from God? It's not going to do me any good. So that's where we're going to start next week. Thanks, everybody, and thanks for bearing with me however long I went over.
I'm sorry.